Off the Map Live, and actually, it's recorded. My name's Gabe Ripley, and usually Ben Licata is your host. He's taken the evening off, but was working overtime, putting together this fantastic episode of his favorite clips. So this whole show's care of Off the Map Tattoo, with locations in East Hampton, Massachusetts, and Grants Pass, Oregon, and soon a location in Italy. So we've got a little video here to show, inviting everyone to the party. And then we'll get on with the best of clips, care of Ben Licata.
So we'll start things off with three early episodes. We've got an interview with Lou Jock, we've got a backbeat done in the day by Dana Helmuth, and then we've got an interview with Mike DeMasi. I hope you like it.
To be honest, I'm not a man of many words, but there's this huge attitude amongst the whole industry that we're all fucking great and whatever. I think it's a joke. That part should probably not get put on. 1992. No, I didn't go to school for art and do any of that stuff. I just always drew in my own free time. More towards the realistic side, but not super realistic. Anything black and gray that's technically done really, really well. Color stuff, it's gotta be done like, got to be different, you know, as long as it's not the same old crap over and over again. I'll respect whoever it is. I don't care how long they've been doing it. I like large-scale stuff, but I also like the little piece that's over and done with in one sitting without any other, you know, unless it needs a little bit of touch-up or something. Sometimes an outline's great, sometimes it's totally not necessary. I come here, off the map. Nah, not too much. I like to stay home with the family. Between tattooing and going home and hanging out with my wife and daughter, it's pretty much takes up most of my time. Luckily, tattooing's kept me busy enough to where I haven't really had time to do much of anything else, but I'm still trying to do a couple album covers here and there. Got another 100 Demons disc coming up to do pretty soon. I mean, I still love music. I still listen to it all day long while I'm working. Couldn't really live without it. It's definitely another way music and tattooing come together, is that I find myself in the middle of listening to something and my hand's going with it the whole time. The mechanics are the same, but the rhythm changes from time to time. I'll either go faster or go slower, or, you know, slow yourself down. Instead of thinking of the whole piece overall, or instead of thinking of the whole tattoo at once, breaking it down into a little section over here and just making sure that technically everything's solid. If you really want to better the industry, fucking make an effort. Instead of fucking going to all the conventions, just getting fucked up the whole time and then going back to your mundane job doing the same shit over and over again. Apprentices should never complain. Ever. You're there to learn a trade that's going to make you money for the rest of your life, and you're going to learn a trade that's going to treat you very well. It gives you a lot of self-confidence when you start to accomplish things that you're proud of, and people treat you very well for it, and they pay you pretty well for it too. So don't complain. No complaining whatsoever. Someone tells you to scrub the toilet, scrub the fucking toilet. Do it and don't question it. Infant probably has better ideas than most adults do anyway.
And that's a wrap.
Right on.
The only competition you have is within yourself. You shouldn't be worried about what other people are doing. You know, if you push to like make it yourself and try your best, you know, it doesn't really matter. It doesn't matter what, you know, someone's doing down the street. It doesn't matter what someone's doing like 50 states away, you know, as long as you're giving it your all. You're exactly what I need. You're an angel with the devil's grin. Will you be kinds of people that talk about making it happen, there's the kinds of people that make it happen, and there's the kind that don't know what the fuck is happening.
Some great tunes in that last one, huh? This next one is when Gabe Ripley was hosting the show. He interviews Ian McCowan in-house and talks to Derb Morrison via Skype. Check it out.
How are you? Welcome to Tattoo Now TV. This is Ian McCowan. He's here with us for our live interview. So what are we doing here? What is Tattoo Now TV? It's a video podcast that we're starting up. This is our third pilot. We're going to get it right this time. And, you know, we're very lucky that in our different businesses, we work with hundreds of different tattooers, connecting clients with fantastic tattooers. And through this, you know, we're able to hear a lot of amazing stories, learn a lot of lessons, and this is our way of bringing it out to the internet world. The show is for you guys, so please send us a feedback, tattoonow at tattoonow.com, and thanks for taking time out of your day to watch this. Hopefully it'll be fun. So why don't we get started? So you've been tattooing you started in the Denver area back in...
Yeah, I started 9 years ago, as of Monday, I think it was 9 years, and I had no ambitions towards being a tattooist or a fine artist or anything. I just happened to be someone that was getting tattooed quite a bit. Mm-hmm. And eventually, I'd asked one of my tattooers like what it took. I was just sort of, you know, curious about tattooing in general. And he kind of laid it out to me, and it sounded kind of interesting. So he said, you know, get some work together, if I thought maybe I wanted to do it. And I was able to get a small portfolio of, you know, really, really crappy drawings together. Mm-hmm. And somehow got the job. And that's been 9 years. Before that, I was corporate, so you know, I was wearing a tie and buttoning my shirts every day. And I'd say now I don't actually own a single button-up shirt, which is good, and no ties, and nothing's wrong with them, of course. But
I'm dressing up for this.
Yeah, I'm dressing up as well, I guess. And it's been good. It's been good in a lot of ways, beyond just being able to, you know, do what we do, which is really a blessing, you know, to work with people. And to like literally, not to put too fine a point on it, to literally, you know, change someone's life in a lot of ways. Because regardless of any impact you may have on their life, they are going to wear this, you know, for the rest of the day. So that's pretty cool.
How the Drew Morrison story started? How long ago when you started tattooing? How'd you get into it?
Okay. You know, when I started tattooing, I started getting tattooed when I was 14, and then around 17 is when I actually picked up doing tattooing, you know, myself, and had always done art, and then I had a bunch of crazy punk rock friends that it really allowed me to kind of, like, just tattoo all those guys and you know, learn kind of, I don't know, in a different realm where there wasn't any consequences or anything like that. So I had a lot of trusting friends that knew I had already done art. And I was, you know, it kind of took a lot of the pressure off of me, like, learning to tattoo. And then those guys were going up to a guy named Tim Miller, who learned from Marty Holcomb and things like that in Columbus, and was showing him a lot of my tattoos that I was doing on those guys. And he saw that I had potential. So pretty much he told me right out of high school to come up there and start working for him. And the rest is history. After that, I started working for Tim's Tattoo Studio right out of high school. He sold the studio when I was about 19 years old, and I packed up with a guy named Dean DeKine, and we moved out to California, and you know, that began all my traveling and kind of really, I guess, learning more outside of just the studio that I was in at the time. You know?
It's John Montavo. You know John, he goes to Hell City.
Oh yeah, Jonathan Montavo, great guy. That piece is super nice. I like that a lot. Got a traditional edge to it with all the new, you know, with all the tricks and stuff. That looks great.
Well, I think his work, aside from a couple tattooers, like say in South Virginia or Virginia, you can really tell his work from just about anybody's out there, and it has... Some of the design elements are just the really strong use of really strong highlights. I mean, they're present on almost every corner of every piece he does. And, you know, I can pick it out of a lineup any day. When I come into my newsfeed, I know exactly who did it. And not only that, he almost always chooses to use this sort of, like, really, not a subdued palette, but everything's very close. And then he has something jumping out at you, you know what I mean? It's just, I don't know. it's a really cool blend, and it's obviously his work whenever you see it, you know.
Genius. I mean,
yeah.
Bottom line, look at that. I mean, like how things go out of focus there, you know.
Awesome. NickBaxter.com, for anybody that doesn't know, they should go immediately there.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Nick's great. Like, when he got into Darkseid, like, you know, I don't know, 6 months, a year into his tattoo, and everybody was like, where did this guy come from? And he just has been going for it ever since. A real inspiration.
Yeah, he really is. I mean, the way his tattoos look are like his paintings, you know. And another thing about Nick's work is it's very, you know, well thought out, has a lot of meaning behind it, you know. So,
well, yeah, I mean,
he's very inspirational. When you look at any of his work, you're wondering what, you know, what's behind it, what's the theory of the piece.
I think another hallmark of his work is he wears a lot of his political beliefs, you know, on his sleeve when it comes to some of the work he approaches.
So you can see from that last video, we haven't really strayed too far from where we began. This next one is a little silly. I talk with Kelly Doty and Marcus Leonard. We stray into some interesting territory. It's a really funny one and one of my favorites.
When I first started doing a lot of like goofy things, it was really, I was surprised that people were letting that happen, because I would, you know, someone would ask for a bird, and I would draw the most idiotic bird ever, and I'd be like, and they would be like, yeah, that's great. And I'd be like, really? You're going to let me do that? Okay. But now I'm still surprised when that happens, actually. But like, I feel like a lot of the time people really want to have something like kind of funny on them. And that makes me happy, because I feel like later in life you're still going to enjoy something funny.
Right.
So I really like to bring a lot of humor in if I can.
Like the nipples on this cat tattoo that we're showing right now.
Yeah.
Those are exceptional.
That's actually, I can't even take credit for those nipples. God help me, I wish I could. But I hadn't thought to put nipples on the cat. And then Russ Abbott gave me a mini like tutorial in nipple drawing. I have a sheet of paper that just has different nipples.
That's
amazing.
He's
like, oh no, you gotta put nipples on the cat, like, of course. And like, he's showing me, you know, well, you could do this type of nipple, or you could do this type of nipple, which is great to have that creepy attention to detail.
It's just such a, the whole tattoo is great, but those nipples really just set it off.
Yeah, I like to think that they were, I don't know if nipples can be flaccid, but if they can, like, they were flaccid before he killed the mouse, and then the thrill of murder really just aroused
very
them.
Very excited.
Yeah.
I lost the whole nipple thing, and I just, that was
Your take on nipples, Marcus?
I don't know. I don't know. I have never contemplated it. I don't have an opinion. I don't really have an opinion. What kind of nipples? I can make an opinion right now. Just ask me something about
cat nipples. Go.
I have never seen nor touched one. I have no opinion. Normally they're covered by hair.
Mm.
But the way you rendered them, no hair.
Yeah.
So I don't even know if it's accurate. I don't know. Do they look like that? Do they look like somebody sticking little pencils from inside the cat?
They do. I have like a whole bunch of cats at home, and that's totally what their nipples look like. I don't care if that's sad.
No. It's sad. It'd be sad if they'd be flaccid.
Right.
That would look really sad. Like 8 mini pigs coming out.
Yeah.
Nipples, huh? One of my favorite bits. This next clip, I talk with Guy Aitchison a little bit about his bio encyclopedia. Guy's been a frequent visitor to the show over the year, and now he has his own show, Hypercast, which comes up right after ours. You should check it out. And he does some really in-depth videos. So here's one from the older days. Hi, welcome to Tattoo Now TV. We're here with Guy Aitchison. We're going to talk a little bit about some upcoming projects he has. Guy, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
So you've got
glad to be here.
You've got the bio encyclopedia coming up. Can you tell us a little bit about what that is?
Well, I mean, we say coming up, you know, it's not on a production schedule right now. I'm still working through a lot of the final layout stuff, but juggling a lot of things. So, yeah, what you're seeing right now are pieces that were done online collaborations. Like that coil there was started by Marco Velazquez from Chicago. Dan Hazelton has worked on that. I've worked on it. There may have been some others involved as well. You'll see exactly who worked on each of them when the book comes out. But we did hundreds of these pieces. That's why I couldn't really tell you off the top of my head that one. I know I was involved in Thad Minnick, Dan Hazelton. Dan was involved in a ton of them. But anyway, this book is going to be hundreds of designs. You know, a lot of them sleeves or stuff that can be broken down and you know redesigned to fit any body part. We're encouraging people to take this stuff and mix and match it. Make it theirs, do their own thing with it, color it how they want it. Some were including multiple different versions, or some are only rough sketches with a lot of room to move. But there's tons of material and, you know, about 100 pages of just theory and, you know, things that you can do to ensure that your biomech designs or any kind of abstract flowing kind of designs are going to fit the body as well as possible and read clearly and, you know, hold them nicely when seen from a distance to be, you know, flattering to the body part, exaggerating the musculature, you know, doing all that stuff the right way. So, yeah, the book's a monster. It's probably going to be close to 500 pages, 10 by 13 inch format. Here you're seeing some different stages of a drawing that Don McDonald and I did. We passed that one back and forth. These are the final two stages. In this image here, where Don had just gone through with colored pencil and white acrylic paint in the left-hand image, and you can see in the right side there's some subtle tweaks that were done to it in Photoshop. And in earlier stages, you can see where we started with a rough sketch Don had done, and you know, then I had lightened it in Photoshop to a point where it was very faint and reprinted it, and then drew it in my own hand, kind of changed some things. Kept others the same. So all of these designs went through all kinds of different stages. There were really no rules other than to, you know, try to work with these images to find the parts of them that you thought were the most interesting and run with those, do your thing with it.
How long have you been working on this project?
Oh gosh, I couldn't tell you. I think it's been close to 3 years, maybe even longer. We started by having a group of these artists, about a dozen of them, came out here to our stead here in the Midwest, and we just sat and art jammed for a few days. And the rest of it is all had to happen online, but we got off to a really good start there. We did a little bit of drawing together at a couple of conventions as well, but most of this has all been you know, stuff we posted on Flickr. We created a private Flickr gallery where we could post things and, you know, comments and things like that. And for a while there, a good year and a half or so, we were all very active in this project. It was a lot of fun. I mean, it was great to, you know, wake up in the morning and over coffee, you know, get out the phone and look at the stuff that was posted, you know, what was done to who's drawing. And, you know, if one of them seemed like the kind of thing you'd want to hop on next. So, yeah, this is the result of that. It was a really unusual 21st century type of project, you know, where before Flickr and that sort of thing, it would have been very difficult for artists to work together in a group like this over such an extended period of time. But, you know, because of the internet, we were able to.
In this next clip, we talk with Jimmy Litwack. He tells us a little bit about being on the TV show, what he's been up to, and how he feels about the way tattooing is going these days. Thanks for sticking with us. Hey, Jimmy, say hello to the good peoples.
How are you guys doing tonight?
Hey, thanks for being with us.
Hey, thanks for having me, man. I definitely appreciate it.
We appreciate you coming on. So you were working at Hart & Huntington down in Florida?
Yeah, I moved down to Florida probably about just the end of December, beginning of January.
How's it treating you down there?
Much better than Vegas did. I like it better here. It's definitely a better environment to raise a family in.
Yeah, I mean, I can understand that. Vegas could probably be a little crazy.
It can be. You know, I think if you're a single person ready to get nuts and crazy, I think it's definitely that's definitely a place to kind of post up and, you know, store your clothes and have a good time. But I don't know. I'm too old now. You know,
I can understand.
Good family and kids trying to raise. You know, I think it's just wasn't for me. You know, it has its stuff, but I just think that, you know, like everything in life, there's always two really good things, just not good for each other. And I think that was just how me and Vegas was.
Right on.
Just wasn't my forte.
Family first.
Definitely, most definitely.
So you've been tattooing for quite a while now. Where did you get your start?
I've been tattooing now 20 years. It'll be 21 years this November. Got my start in Southwest Detroit, Michigan, my hometown. You know, just it'll always be home. But that's
just like that journey
where I got my start from.
Right?
Yeah, yeah.
So did you have a traditional apprenticeship? Are you self-taught?
No, I had a straight up traditional hardcore apprenticeship, you know, kind of the old Karate Kid, you know, thing where you're doing shit and wondering what the hell does this have to do with anything with tattooing? And, you know, the answer was always, it'll make you a better tattooer, you know, going from mowing lawns and, you know, going grocery shopping and picking guys up from the bar at 2-3 o'clock in the morning to drop them off. And, you know, like, you know, it was probably about I'd say a good year and a half before they ever let me even touch a tattoo machine. You know, I had it was pretty grueling. You know, I mean, I'm thankful and appreciating and grateful for everything that, you know, went into it. I think that's what a lot of the industry now is really lacking, you know, is that good old school hardcore apprenticeship of being able, you know, there's some things that, you know, I think people really miss out on, you know, being able, being taught that way.
Yeah, there's a little bit of ass kicking missing from, tattoo people might be getting a little soft, you know.
I not only did you get the ass kicking, but literally you got an ass kicking. There was you know, like, it wasn't just some entitlement, you know, that, you know, well, I've been apprenticing for 3 months, so, you know, I should own my own shop now, you know, like. I remember this one time I questioned them about, like, I scrubbed a bunch of tubes and autoclaved them. And, you know, he ripped them all out of the bag and was like, do them over again. And I was like, what the hell for? You know, like, dude, I cleaned them. They were good, you know. And he's like, you just do it. You don't ask. And I was like, well, what does that matter? And he was like, you know what? You're right. Go home for a week.
Oh, shit.
And, dude, and it broke my heart, man. I was bummed out. You know, like, I was like, oh, my God, did I just mess up my opportunity? You know, I was so sad. And, you know, it was like a week later, you know, and he called me up. He's like, you ready to come back in? And I was like, yeah, man. You know, he left me back and he's like, just don't ever question, man. He's like, you know, what I'm trying to instill into you is, you know, not to be lazy. You know, if something needs to be done, you might not want to do it. You just got to do it. And I was like, well, shit, you couldn't have just told me that message. You know, you didn't have to fucking, you know, like, ground me or nothing. He's like, yeah, I did. You know, it just shows that you wanted it. You know, if it affects you that much, it just shows you where your passion and your heart really truly lies. And, you know, it was a lot of those kind of moments throughout my apprenticeship.
You have a very vivid memory of that. So apparently it worked. It worked really very well.
There's so many times, like, you know, back in my apprenticeship, as you know, when we actually still handmade needles ourselves, and I remember every Sunday was needle making day, and, you know, I would try to, you know, make needles for the whole shop. And I remember I had probably about 150 needles made, and you know, he comes walking by, and I was like so happy. It's like, well, you know, maybe I, you know, this should be enough for the week. You know, maybe even 2 weeks. You know, it'd be good. You know, figure I could maybe take a Sunday off. And he walked up and he grabbed him by his hand and he just looked at him all. He's like, okay, cool. And he just went, wham!
Oh,
smashed them all on the table and goes, do them all over again.
Oh shit!
I felt like my heart just shattered. I was like, fuck, really?
So right. You want to tell us who this guy was, or do you want to keep it a secret?
No. I apprenticed under a guy named Chuck Gruhl.
Okay.
He was a pretty awesome guy. Yeah, he was the one who really started to open my eyes up to like tattooing of like the, you know, like the actual art and respect of it. You know, there was a, you know, I was young. I started getting, you know, I got my first tattoo when I was 15. And I started hanging around the tattoo shop, like, you know, a lot when I was like 16, 17. And, you know, it was just visually cool to me, you know, just seeing all the different personalities and the people in there and just the camaraderie that they had in the shop. It would just seem so appealing to me. It seemed like a family or a brotherhood, you know. It was like, you know, it's like me being able to hang out at a bar without being in a bar, you know. It was just cool just to watch the vibe, you know, of how everyone just interacted there. And, it just really drew me to it, you know, in this art form, you know. My childhood dream was to be an animator. That's what I wanted to do. Okay. I wanted to do something with art, but, you know, getting it, you know, hanging out at the tattoo shop, it was one of those things that, you know, I was like, wow, man, there's something to this, you know. And he really started to educate me about really what all goes into it, you know. And you know, it didn't have to have some artsy-fartsy meaning, but, you know, in a sense, there kind of was. There was a sense of, you know, like a personal, you know, story to oneself. It was really alluring to me, you know, and I kind of fell into it.
This next one is a Skype interview we did with Bob Tyrell. He talks a little bit about apprenticeships and how he got started tattooing. Bob's a great guy to talk to and an awesome fucking dude.
What's happening, Ben?
Hey, Bob, how you doing, man?
Good, man. How you doing?
I'm good. Where are you at right now?
I'm in Atlanta, Georgia.
How's everything in Atlanta? Is it hot? Like, it's hot here?
Yeah, it is hot. It's like, it's about 86 degrees to be exact. That's, when I looked earlier.
That's what we got here. What are you doing? Cool. What are you doing in Atlanta?
I came for Tony Leavis's convention here. I was supposed to be here the whole weekend, and then I got Rolling Stones tickets in Chicago. And I looked at my phone calendar, which everything's in there, I thought. And I'm like, okay, cool, May 31st, I got nothing going that weekend. So I bought these tickets, and it was like almost $900 for two tickets, you know. Whoa. And then I'm like, oh, fuck, man, it's the weekend of Atlanta.
So
I'm like, shit. So I talked to Tony. I'm like, dude, you mind if I come Saturday?
Right on.
He's like, yeah, man. How was this? So I saw this. Drove to Chicago from Detroit. My buddy drove. We saw the Stones. And then Saturday morning, I flew here. Got here at like 4 o'clock yesterday afternoon. And now I got to go to the airport at like 3:45. So I'm here like 24 hours exactly.
God damn.
I gotta fly out, so yeah, it's kind of nutty. But
how do you?
So I didn't work.
How do you handle? How do you handle all that traveling?
I don't know, man. I'm tired.
What's your secret?
Patron. Drink lots of coffee and lots of tequila.
Right on. So where's your next destination? Boston.
Yeah, I gotta fly to Newark tonight, and then I'm gonna be there tomorrow, and I'm gonna drive to Boston. Tomorrow night, Monday night. So I'll be there, and then I'm kind of all over the place. I'm going to Toronto this month. The end of the month, I'm going to Europe. So I'm going to France, Amsterdam, and maybe Germany.
Damn.
It's going to be a crazy 6 weeks. And then mid-July, I'll be home for 2 months, I hope.
You hope.
When I get back from Europe, July 9th or 10th, and then I'm going down to Cincinnati, like, a few days later. And then after that, I'm home.
So
enjoy some of the summer at home, you know.
You're coming in for the Worldwide Tattoo Conference, yes?
Yeah.
I'm
stoked.
What are you going to be doing there?
Thanks.
That's a cold beer. I'm totally jealous right now.
It's a hot coffee.
Fuck. All right.
It's morning for me. I just got up at 1 p.m. So this is totally morning for me. But no, this Worldwide Tattoo Conference, it's awesome. I did it once in Chicago in 2 days of just like school, you know. It's there's six seminars. So six of us each do a 2-hour seminar. So the first day is three of us. I think I'm on the first. I am on the first day.
Yep.
Let me shut this off. So we each do a 2-hour seminar, and then at the end there's a discussion panel with all six artists on both days. It's an awesome thing. I had a blast last time. Like, I learned a lot last time. Like, you know, I've taken all these seminars myself too, and it's just like it's a lot of information to soak in over 2 days. You know, it's really, really cool experience.
What's your seminar all about?
Mine's just on pretty much just what I do, you know, black and gray. It focuses on portraits and photorealism because that's kind of my main thing. But I also love doing, you know, horror, custom horror imagery and freehand stuff sometimes, and which is kind of a lot different than realistic work. It's a nice change, you know. I could do portraits every day for the rest of my life and not get sick of them. But it's also fun to just draw on somebody and just have fun, you know, creating some monster or something. I'm a huge horror fan, so I love doing that stuff. But my seminar, I'll talk about just my technique and just how I do stuff and, you know, everything to do with how I tattoo. But like I said, it's a little more based on doing a black and gray portrait, because that's my main thing. So
for some folks who aren't familiar with you, which I'm sure there are only a few, but you started tattooing a little bit later in life. You had a regular day job for years. How did you get into tattooing? Who got you into it?
You know, I'd wanted to get a tattoo since I was like 19. And I had this buddy who joined the Marines, and every time he came home, he had more work. And he was getting, his arms were getting pretty heavily covered. And, you know, I thought it was the coolest thing in the world. I was like, man, I want to get tattooed. And throughout my 20s, I would go into, every couple of years, I might go look in, go into a shop and look around. And I was going into the worst shops, you know. All my friends had bad tattoos on the side of town I lived on. They're like, go see this guy, Red. You know, he's 70 years old, but he shakes. But when he touches your skin, he gets dead. You know, those kind of people that people are like referring me to. You know?
Oh man, nice friends.
And I went in his shop. Yeah, and I was pretty ignorant about the whole thing. I thought you had to, you know, pick something off the wall. I didn't realize people were doing custom imagery, or you could bring in, you know, like an album cover or something. And I just thought you had to go in there, pick something off the wall if they didn't have it. You know, so I looked around and I didn't see anything I wanted. You know, and then I was a month shy of turning 30, and I'm like, I gotta get tattooed before I turn 30. I waited long enough. I went in the closest shop to my house, and I got Eddie from Iron Maiden on my arm. And
classic.
It was horrible. The guy butchered it. You know, it was horrible. but I was still stoked to have a tattoo, you know. And then I found somebody a little better, and started getting my work on both my upper arms. And at that point, I started buying tattoo magazines, and I'm like, oh my God, you know, I didn't realize what kind of work was being done out there in the world. And I saw an article on Paul Booth, one of those first magazines, and it's like, that's exactly the kind of work I'm looking for. Paul was, he was tattooing like 4 or 5 years at that point, but he was just getting big at that point. And it's like, that's exactly the kind of stuff I want. And I booked an appointment with Paul and got a full back piece. And that was like my first real tattoo. So that's, you know, for 15 years, I had a job making kitchen countertops, and I played in bands all through my 20s. That's, I wanted to, you know, make it in the music business or whatever was my goal for a long time, and that didn't go anywhere. You know, I did that for 15 years, and after I quit drawing when I started playing guitar when I was 14, so, like, I didn't draw at all from, like, you know, except for high school art class or something, from 15 years old to about, you know, 30, but I got my first tattoo, that kind of made me want to start drawing again. Like, I'm like, I'm going to try drawing some skulls and stuff. And then I just totally got, fell in love with drawing again, you know. And so I was, you know, drawing skulls and stuff like that. And then I took a basic drawing one art class at the community college. You know, so I was going like 2 nights a week. And I learned I just learned the basics again, you know, like how light falls on objects and real simple stuff like that, perspective. But I learned a shitload in that one class, and it totally got me back into drawing. And I took a basic drawing 2 class, and then I took a life drawing class after that, and just because I was having fun taking art classes, you know. So I took those 3 classes, and I spent about 3 years getting my drawing back together and thinking about tattooing the whole time, but I was kind of scared, you know, like, you know, what if I fuck somebody up? What if I stick myself and catch something? Or so I wasn't like totally set, like, so just thinking, man, I wouldn't mind learning how to tattoo. It seems like a cool fucking job. But so after about 3 years, I'm like, okay, I have to learn how to tattoo. That whole time I was getting pretty heavily covered. So I had full sleeves, a full back piece before I was tattooing. And just over those 3 years, as time went on, you know, I just kept wanting more and more to learn how to tattoo. And then, so after 3 years, I'm like, all right, I have to, you know. So I got an apprenticeship at Eternal, and it was a quick 3-month apprenticeship. I did 6 tattoos and started working full time.
Who were you? Who were you apprenticing with?
You know, the amazing thing is, you know, I went to Eternal Tattoos, which was like the best shop in Detroit in 1997 when I started, and Tom Renshaw happened to be working there, and he was like the best portrait artist in the world, you know, in the shop I apprenticed in, you know, so I couldn't have learned in a better shop. And Tom, I was going in there every night after my day job from like 6 to 9 o'clock at night. And everybody apprenticed me in the shop, and Tramp's the owner of the shop. And the first day he taught me how to make needles and stuff. And then after that, he's just like, watch the guys work, ask questions, just observe, you know? And so I watched everybody.
This next one's a recent interview that we did with Carlos Torres. Carlos is one of the best interviews we've ever had. He's a great guy to talk to. I hope you enjoy this.
I've been looking at his work since I was apprenticing.
6 months ago?
Yeah. Still.
Hey,
still
Carlos. Apprenticing.
Yo!
Hey, man. Welcome to Off the Map Live.
Hey, how you guys doing?
We're good. You are live to the internet right now.
Whoa.
So don't say
it. Is this like those chat rooms?
Don't get too dirty.
Just kidding.
We're not Snapchatting here. This is permanent. We're recording this. So hey, thanks.
Right, how are you guys doing tonight?
We're good. How are you doing?
I'm all right. Yeah, it's a good Sunday.
Oh, right on, man. So what have you been up to lately? You been doing any traveling?
I've actually had a couple months off. I'm probably hit the road in a little bit. Going to Singapore in the mid-December.
Oh, yeah?
And then January starts all the traveling again. But it's been nice to have a little bit of time off. Like just really doing a lot of painting, drawing, trying to create some new stuff. So
yeah,
it's nice.
You haven't been doing a lot of tattooing recently? You've been doing more painting and things like that?
Yeah. Actually, I did. I took a lot of time off to finish a painting for shows.
Uh-huh.
It's kind of tough, you know, tattooing and then you come home and paint and... So some days I just got to take the day off and end up painting the whole day. But, yeah, I mean, I'd rather be tattooing, to be honest with you.
I've seen your paintings, and they're amazing. How long have you been painting?
It's probably seriously about 7 years now. About 7 years.
So what drew you to painting? What drew you to doing that?
Man, I started off like going to Europe, like doing a lot of conventions over there, like right off the bat. Like I didn't even do too many over here. So just walking around anywhere in Europe is just super inspiring. All the oil paintings and stuff. And I think the first time I saw Sean Barber's work and saw like, oh man, this guy's a tattoo artist and he can do that, or he was mainly a fine artist first, but he was in the tattoo world. It mm-hmm. just kind of opened my eyes and just made me not so intimidated by like oil painting, I guess.
So, do you think painting helps your tattooing?
Yeah, without a doubt.
Yeah,
without a doubt. Yeah.
In what ways?
I think that anything that you do, artistic, is gonna feed the other, you know, in any medium that you work on. I mean, anything that you do, photography, painting, drawing, anything, I think that it'll help your tattooing because I think your creative mind gets better in tattooing. You start doing, you know, right now I'm really searching to do stuff that really hasn't been done or seen, I guess you could say, like imagery wise.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
See it a lot with the stuff that you've translated from your painting to the tattoo work, like the lady with the birdcage.
Oh, yeah.
That works phenomenal. And the one that's got the ship on her head?
Yeah.
Like the painting had what was that, the Queen Mary?
The Queen Mary, yeah.
And yeah. You changed it to a clipper ship. What made you do that?
You know, the painting was actually commissioned for the Ink and Iron Festival out here in Long Beach. And so I think just tattoo-wise, I think it looked cooler. I mean, with the old, you know, clipper pirate ship, you know, that's...
Oh, yeah.
It's cool. Rad
it's totally rad, man. It's awesome.
How many sittings you put into that?
You know, I lost the amount of sittings, but I know it was a little over 60 hours.
Damn.
So I think we were looking at 61, maybe 62 hours.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you ever have a hard time finding clients that are willing to put in that kind of investment, or is it pretty easy for you now at this point in your career?
At this point in my career, it's pretty easy, I guess you could say, without sounding too arrogant or something, but it's been a lot easier. And man, sometimes I sit back and think, like, man, how did I reach this point in my career that, you know, just to do something like, you know, do a sketch, or, you know, I do a lot of sketches in like a sketchbook on the airplane, and then I'll get to a convention, like, or I'll put it on the internet and be like, who wants this? And I get people who volunteer. Like, that's pretty wild to me.
Oh, man, I've seen your ballpoint pen on, like, coasters before, and I was like, damn, that's fucking badass. I would love that, because they're, you know, they're good. They're really great. So I know you must get tons of contact from potential clients. Do you have any how do you pick and choose which clients you're going to work on? Because, I mean, I'm sure you get enough where you would never be able to tattoo everyone that wants to be tattooed by you. So how do you filter them out?
Again, right now, I think I'm really just kind of going by the idea, you know, and then also a little bit the freedom that they give me. But like, if they give me a really cool idea, something that just really, I guess, grabs me, then that's kind of how I'm filtering them out. I kind of trying to step away from portraits a little bit right now. So, I don't want to sound like I don't want to do portraits, but I grew up doing a lot of drawing and fantasy art and comic book stuff, and so I kind of really want to take it back to that, just being more creative, I guess.
Right on. Hey, I've got some questions for you from our chat room. Some folks are watching. This one's a painting question. Someone would like to know, what's a good brand of paints and brushes for a beginner?
For a beginner, yeah, really, I really, really like those. What I'm using now is the Winsor & Newton, the University series.
Uh-huh. Hey, you got some right there.
Yeah, they're there.
These here?
Nice.
Yeah. I've been using, I really like using those for a la primas, and like actually to get a lot of the paint on there. I've been using... just anything like hog hair, it seems to really get the paint on there really nice and thick.
Right on. What about paints? What are you using for paints?
I do kind of a mix. Winsor & Newton, some of the Grumbachers, and what is that? The Old Holland, man.
Old Holland, sure.
Yeah.
Damn ground.
Going broke Old Holland.
Yeah.
Yeah. Those are expensive, but man, those are some nice paints.
But I don't know. I would say I'm a beginner painter, and I would say, you know, spend a little bit of extra money. You don't have to buy all the colors. Buy a few colors, but buy good paint, because the pigment is going to show up a lot better. A lot of the student paints just don't have it. You know, like, you get lots of paint, but you don't get nearly as much pigment. You know, it's just
yeah.
You could take after Jeff Gogway and just, you could use three colors, you know, just get good paint.
Good paint weighs heavy.
You know?
Man, I don't know how that guy does it. That guy's like a god. It's just, I could get the same three colors and never come up with what he comes up with.
Yeah, I haven't figured it out. You know, I've sat through his seminar. I can't figure it out.
Well, that one didn't suck, and neither does this next one. Here's an interview we did with Sean Barber. All right, well, right now we're showing the tattoo of the elephants.
Oh, yeah.
The locomotion tattoo there.
Yeah, that guy's great.
That's a pretty badass tattoo.
Thanks. I've noticed that your tattoos are starting to take a turn for solid, like, tattoos, like, traditional almost, with, like, bold lines and, like, saturated colors. Is that intentional?
Yeah, for sure. Yeah.
You're less painter-like and more tattoo-like.
Yeah, I think there's a lot of sayings people have, and they're all silly. I told Kim bold will hold, and she said bold will get old.
Oh, that's funny.
No, I don't know. I like the way they look. I think the like a lot of graphic elements in tattoos just look powerful. If you can tell what something is from across a room, like, that's a statement. I like detailed stuff in black and gray where you can kind of tweak out on it, like, you know, it's from close up, but outside of that, I don't know. There's something about composing and designing with shapes so you can appreciate the tattoo from, you know, 20 feet, 10 feet, 5 feet, 1 feet, 1 inch, you know?
Yeah. Hey, if you had any advice for someone that was looking to get a really great tattoo and how to go about it, what would you say to them?
I would have them educate themselves a little bit on the style of tattoos that are out there, and then think about subject matter. You know, I think everything's based off subject, and if you're, you know, I think a lot of people feel like they might have to force meaning into a tattoo, but they can just appreciate the art of it and get something that looks nice. You know,
do you think someone should be patient, or you think they should just find the cheapest guy in town, or?
I think everybody gets the tattoos they deserve, and you live with the choices you make. You know.
Yeah.
And if you're impatient, then you're going to get tattoos that reflect that, you know?
So you're still getting tattooed.
I get tattooed all the time.
I see you just got one from Zulu.
That's right, Zulu.
Yeah, man. It's a badass tattoo.
It's pretty sick.
Is there any artists? There any artists out there that you're looking to get tattooed by, or you just play it by ear and roll with it?
Just friends.
Yeah.
Just friends. Yeah, I want to get tattooed by friends. I don't have a lot of space left, so...
You got to do your face next, I guess, huh?
No, I'm not doing that.
I'm just kidding.
Yeah, I'm trying to tattoo more. I think the next goal for me would be outside of, like, finishing all the weight that's been, you know, in front of me. I've been taking a lot of jobs just because I have a lot of back tax debt, and I have... student loans and just like everybody, I got bills. And some of that weight of that debt's alleviating. So I think the next step is to start doing some art pieces, illustrations for tattoos. Like, you know, what would be fun to make and put on the body? And I think, bless you. I think, I don't know, I think that's the next step, I think, to translate.
This was a hell of a show. I talked with BJ Betts, Damon Conklin is in-house, Corey Ferguson, and Jeff Gogue.
Advice for collectors, Damon?
Advice for collectors?
Yeah, the best way to find a good tattoo.
Probably on Instagram. Except the screen's only 2 inches.
Shit.
Everything looks good on Instagram. No, you know, I mean, obviously you go online and you find out who you want work from, or, I don't know, watch Spike TV or whatever, you know. But then, you know, going to conventions is always good. You can talk to people in person, you know. But going to conventions is the best if you're trying to reach waiting list tattooers. Because then you become a person.
Right. You're not an email.
You're not an email, you know, so... I mean, that'd be my biggest piece of maybe not so obvious advice.
Right on. Yeah. How about you guys? Any of you three out there?
Sorry, I missed the question. I apologize.
Well, advice for a collector, someone that's looking to get, you know, a great tattoo. What's one piece of advice you could give them?
I'd say book early, man. Especially if it's somebody that they really want to get tattooed by, because, like, I'm sure Corey and Jeff, these guys have a waiting list longer than my, well, you know, let's just say it's long. And, no, seriously. I mean, I'd say as soon as the list of artists goes up on whatever website or whatever convention they're planning on attending, definitely try and get a hold of the guys through email as soon as possible. Or if you know they're returning for another year, you know, then contact them and try and make it happen because, I know for myself, man, I love tattooing repeat clients and, I don't want to say I give those guys like, head of the line privileges, but I mean, I'd like to, if it was a good, enjoyable experience the first time, you know?
Mm-hmm. I know for a fact that Jeff actually doesn't have a waiting list anymore. Haley just put that out there.
she was protecting me.
Yeah. But, no more bothering my dad. You know,
she does. She's protective in a lot of ways. But no, I mean, of course, I take on new clients, and I have not necessarily a waiting list, but there are people that are building. I guess just a case to get tattooed. You know, I mean, it's people that I've either met in person and got to know over the years, or at shows. You know, they start becoming familiar, and you get to know them. You know, especially doing larger scale work, you're going to be spending 2 or 3 years with this person, you know, 50 to 100 hours with them, thousands of dollars. Like, you don't just jump into that lightly and just take on whoever's next on the list.
Right.
You know, it's you want to be compatible with your client. If it was a 4-hour tattoo, you could survive almost anyone. But when you're talking about a 4-year project, yeah, you want to be careful. So.
Right.
It's just, I think it depends on the artist and what they're going after as far as building their portfolio and building up their body of work.
Do you ever get a difficult client?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, how do you deal with that? How do you deal with that?
Just like anything else, you just go, I will survive this. You know, it's like, you just, I mean, every person is different, so every interaction is going to be different. And some people you have to, you know, be a little strong with, and others you can be a little more passive, and you just got to be adjustable, I think, and be willing to meet people where they're at. And if you can't, then you say, well, I'm not the person for you.
Yeah, and that's the, sorry to interrupt, but that's, I think, man, Jeff, that's the best part of, you know, of one of the best parts of what we do, man, is being able to do that and say that, you know what I mean? And being, especially at this point with you, man, you can pretty much pick and choose what, and Corey, for that, you know, for that matter as well, like pick and choose what you want to do and make it fun and make this, you know, what we love tattooing, what we love so much about tattooing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree. And I think that, I just think that, like your question, Ben, about tattooing, that is the beauty of where we're at now is I see a maturing happening, and I see, you know, you can get a good tattoo just about anywhere, you know, and so there's a lot more choices for clients out there, and there's a lot more, I guess, dependability on for the general public to get a good tattoo. And to me, it just spreads the love around, you know, I mean, we can all stay busy and do what we want to do. And if you're not super busy and you need more, then, you know, step up your game.
Right.
Absolutely.
So you guys all see
sometimes. Oh.
No, go ahead.
I was going to say sometimes, yeah, it's a matter of if you want to find that artist, you know, ask them what they want to do. If you're, you know, if you're really dying to get tattooed by somebody and they're not necessarily, you know, feeling your idea or whatever, but you don't want anyone else to do it, then, you know, as you get to that stage where we're like so lucky that we get to be picky about our clients now, it comes down to like who's asking for what I'm really feeling right now. So if you know, if you're open and you let your artist know, like, you know, you can just kind of go off and do your thing, and then, you know, you got a good shot of getting in, at least with me right now. That's sort of how I'm choosing at the moment, is by those criteria.
Sure.
Yeah.
Next up, we have an interview with recent Off the Map partner, Alex Apasse, and the man behind the Worldwide Tattoo Conference. Next year's Worldwide Tattoo Conference is coming up in Venice in November. We'll be webcasting live from the event. Mark your calendars. Check out worldwidetattooconference.com for more info. Can you just tell us a little bit about your history for some people that don't know when you started tattooing?
Yes, of course. You know, I've been tattooing since I was 14. and now I'm almost 38. So it's about 23 years, you know, it's a lot. But my career changed about seven, eight years ago. And when I decided to change my style, my tattoo style, my art style, I put all myself in what I was doing, and everything changed in one moment.
Yeah, I've seen some of your earlier work, and then I've seen work, you know, your most recent work, and there was a very definite change. It was very drastic. It was amazing.
This is what I explained in my seminar, you know, because sometimes you're able to do something, but probably you don't know, you know, it's something you have to change in your brain, and from one day to the other, you're able to do something completely different. And that's what's happened to me, you know.
Someone would like to know how your creative process evolves, like how your process for tattoos evolves.
But, you know, I was not the normal process to me, you know. I was talking in the normal kind of work, you know, line, dark, and then light colors, you know. And then I approach other different arts, you know. I'd approach, for example, the airbrush. I approach oil painting, you know. And in this technique, you know, you use a lot the overlayering. Was not so used in the tattoos, you know. And I thought, why not use in the tattoos? You know, and that's what I did, you know. I tried, of course. I did some mistake at the beginning. The big mistake was very easy to broke the skin, you know, in this way. So I developed my technique step by step until now, where I found a good way to obtain a good result without damage the skin, in order to have a perfect healing.
And they look amazing.
Thank you.
I love your work, man.
Thank you.
So, in the coming year, we're going to be taking the show on the road. We're going to be visiting a convention near you. We're going to visit Hell City, Toronto, Cape Fear, Detroit, and a bunch of others that I can't really remember right now because my head is so full of alcohol. So here's an example of what we do live on stage. This is an interview we did with Marcus Leonard and Russ Abbott live from the Paradise Tattoo Gathering this year in Keystone, Colorado.
Welcome to Tattoo Now TV, which is a show that I host bi-weekly on the interwebs. Marcus Leonard and Russ Abbott were kind enough to join me for this. If you guys want to come up and listen, this is going to be pretty cool. We're going to touch on a few topics about tattooing. Welcome, Marcus.
Hi, how are you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
Great. Doing good.
Tell the folks a little bit about yourself.
I am Marcus Leonard. I am from Germany. Tattooing mostly biomech, specializing in that, using digital media to get to my designs. And yeah, that's pretty much it.
How about you, Russ?
I'm Russ Abbott. I'm from Atlanta, Georgia. Been tattooing since 1997. Specialize in illustrative tattooing, sometimes more realistic, sometimes more traditional. Also use digital media in my design process, and have fully exploited the digital era in all aspects of my business. So
we're going to talk a little bit about today. Yeah, we're going to talk a little bit about the digital age of tattooing, I suppose. Technology, right. How it's affected it, pros, cons. You guys both use Photoshop?
I use Photoshop all the time. It's pretty much all I use, yeah. Haven't used paper in, I guess, like 5 years almost.
What are the advantages?
It's fast. It's good for people that don't have patience like I have, you know? So, yeah, it's great. You just get to have a lot of iterations of the same design that you wouldn't get, like, if you have to do it on paper. So, that's what I get out of it.
Right. I've been using Photoshop, you know, to edit my photos for portfolios and things like that for years. So, you know, when it came time to start designing tattoos in Photoshop, I already had a little bit of a head start. But actually, I was inspired by Marcus and his use of the, and the Cintiq, the Wacom Cintiq tablet, where you can actually draw directly on the monitor. Basically, it's a display, but it's also a pressure-sensitive tablet. The one we both have is the 24 HD. It's this wide. It has an articulating mount that it comes off the table and you adjust the angle.
Yeah.
And you know, Photoshop is what Marcus uses. I use.
We've got a little representation up here.
Oh yeah, that's my setup. That's my old setup, actually. Yeah.
So what actually is in the photo there?
So yeah, I got like, that's my recent setup. I can't see it that well. So yeah, I got multiple screens that I work off of. Got like one or two screens for reference and controlling what I'm actually doing. And one screen that I just use for whatever I need to procrastinate. Like internet, Facebook, music, whatever, movies. And that's how I work. So I pretty much immerse myself in my work environment for a couple of hours. And yeah, it's pretty good. It keeps you focused.
That's a really impressive setup. It's like an evil lair kind of. You're just surrounded by all these monitors. And
it's like a bat cave a little bit, yeah.
You just need one more step. You need to be able to plug yourself into it.
You know,
Matrix style.
I tried that, but that didn't work out too well. Nah.
So how are some other ways that technology has affected tattooing in general?
I mean, I think the obvious answer is things like MySpace first, allowing tattooers to have easily accessible portfolios. You know, before that, those of us who were willing to put in the effort for websites and to get good ones were had a little bit of an advantage over everyone else. MySpace sort of leveled that playing field, and then to Facebook, and now Instagram is where we're all really spending a lot of time, and we enjoy using that. So, that environment is really changing the dynamic of how people look at tattoo artists and how they find out about styles. I mean, if you go back to maybe even 10 years ago, an artist who's kind of a thought leader could go out and do a tattoo and then submit it to a magazine, and then there would be a 6-month wait before anyone would see the magazine, and so it took longer for styles to get digested and regurgitated. But now it's almost impossible to tell who thought of that weird way to draw, an eye socket on a skull.
Right.
Before you see it like
instantly.
Pop all over the world instantly. So.
Oh yeah, and you can control it yourself, what you put up there and how you want to be received.
Yeah,
if you
want to keep something a secret for yourself and explore a style, you almost have to keep it off the internet until you've done it 10 times. And then you can kind of like let it go on the world and then
see if
it gets picked up or not. Yeah. And I guess that's sort of a fun game to play.
Yeah, it's pretty exciting what's happening, actually. If you came up with MySpace, right? MySpace, Facebook, now it's Instagram. It's getting simpler and simpler and simpler. So people, it makes it easier for more and more people to not only put their shit out, but also to consume it.
Yeah.
It's like only just like these little square pictures for everybody.
Right.
So, and you can use the hashtags. It's actually pretty cool because a lot of people are using the hashtags for this convention too, like a hashtag tattoo gathering or hashtag paradise tattoo gathering. And you kind of get to know a lot of people that you don't really see walking around all the time because you're working and you don't really see what's going on. So later on after the show, I go on Instagram and I check out that hashtag and see what's been going on all day.
It's really cool. Like here at the show, I finished a piece last night and I posted it to Instagram, and then as I'm walking through the hallway to the bathroom, everyone's like, man, I like that. Nice piece, man.
Yeah, that's
and
awesome.
I know they all saw it on Instagram. They didn't come by and see it in person.
So that's it. That was the best of 2013 and a little bit more than that. I hope you had a good time watching it. We had a great time making it. This coming year is the year of too much fun. Every 2 weeks, we're going to be doing live parties for the show. You can have one at your place. I hope you party along with us. This next season is going to be great. Make sure you come back and see more. Oh, and about those parties, make sure you go to tattoonowtv.com for all the info. You can put in, hey, we're back, 1,000 times. Hey, we're back. Hey, we're back. Or, right on. My standard interview answer. Oh, right on. Rad. This is ridiculous. I'll just get drunk for the Alex one. All right, this one, I'm talking with Alex. Alex is a great fucking guy, I love him. He's got a shop in Italy. It's cool. Oh, this is an interview we did with him. We can't.
Oh, fuck, that's bullshit. We'll be right back.